I'm Kurt Tarani. I'm a senior staff scientist at Oak Ridge National Laboratory, and I'm the technical director of the Transformational Challenge Reactor, or TCR. TCR is a small reactor. We call it a micro reactor. It's an advanced reactor. It's cooled with a helium gas, so you can go to much higher temperature than currently operating nuclear reactors. What's important about it is that we haven't built an advanced reactor in this country in about four decades, 40 years. But really, it's the wrong philosophy. The philosophy. So imagine, basically, the old philosophy is that let's take one of these dragons from the Game of Thrones series and put the dragon. It's a very powerful being. Okay. Put the dragon inside of a cage, okay, and harness its power. But you know what? If the dragon gets out, it's going to be a mess, right? So let's put a few other cages around it, and let's call that defense in depth, okay? So this is how we convince ourselves that we're safe, but occasionally some extreme event happens, and the dragon gets out, and we're all concerned, okay? What we're saying today is that instead of putting one of those dragons in there, get a hamster, get a little bunny. So lower your power density. Under the TCR program, we're 3D printing a core. It's a 0.8 meter diameter, 0.8 meter tall, maybe a large keg of beer. It consists of micro-encapsulated nuclear fuel particles or nuclear fuel with some coating layers around them that keep all the radionuclides inside. These particles are inside a 3D printed silicon carbide matrix that forms a complex fuel block. This is a Cadillac of a nuclear fuel. It's got all these barriers to radionuclide release. It's in a refractory ceramic carbide matrix. It can go to very, very high temperatures, withstand very, very harsh environments. So we take our fuel, these fuel blocks, and then we combine them with what we call a moderator, which you need to slow down the neutrons that have a small core. And you want to have hydrogen in it. So for moderator, we're using yttrium hydride. That's one of these, again, brand new materials that hasn't been used before. And we basically combine the yttrium hydride in stainless steel structures and put our silicon carbide fuel blocks around it. And that forms our core. And all these components are additive and advanced manufactured. Advanced manufacturing brings that into the third thing we do when we are 3D printing. We sneak in some sensors. We embed sensors in there. So we generate hundreds of gigabytes of data compressed when we make a part. And we feed that data into our machine learning algorithms that we're training today to try to correlate these signatures that we see during advanced manufacturing to final performance of the part. The machine learning algorithm doesn't need health insurance, pension, you know. So it's automate this and step away. And they can be far more powerful than a human judgment, okay? Because they can process a lot more data. So for the first time, we have an incredibly data-rich approach to qualification. The two are very distinct. The accident that happened in Ukraine in Chernobyl is what happened to a reactor that had an inherent design flaw. Okay, the Western reactor since the beginning, they've always been built that there's this thing called the negative feedback. Okay, so if things get hot, if the temperatures go up, by not because some pump activates or things like that, by laws of physics, the fission reaction stops. Okay. The Eastern reactor, the RBMK in Ukraine that happened in Chernobyl, it didn't have that negative feedback. So that was a wholly different class of a disaster. Okay, but now let's take a look at the Western reactors that again TMI and Fukushima represent. This goes back to the same conversation we're having. You know, the design and the philosophy of building these systems was 1950s and 60s philosophy. Okay, so what they did in a nutshell, they came in and they said, hey, let's define these really extreme scenarios. Okay, let's call these bounding design basis accidents. And they define these extreme scenarios. And they said anything that happens beyond that is beyond design basis. It's really not going to happen. But in Fukushima, you know, they didn't design for a 9.9 plus Richter magnitude earthquake. A tsunami comes in and this disaster happened. You got to dial that down. You got to bring that power density down. And then you have inherently benign systems that are not susceptible. You don't need these active safety systems. And then, and when you remove that, then you remove all this concrete, all this shield, all this containment, all this battery, diesel. So the cost comes up. So we need simpler, smaller, more benign systems. And people have known this for a very long time. But the problem is that when you haven't built anything since late 1970s, okay, when you're still stuck with 1950s and 60s technology, you can't implement these changes. So that's what we're trying to do, is to demonstrate new advanced systems that have inherently safe without, you know, you don't want to have a big exclusion zone around them or things like that. You can drop them in different places, connect them to the grid, and they can be load following. The whole infrastructure is moving in that direction. And you know, and the new nuclear with a smaller, lower power micro reactors really lends itself to this new landscape. Ultimately, the vision is to go ahead and build affordable, reliable, inherently safe, and proliferation-resistant systems, okay, that you can ship around the world. Think of it, you know, and I think the best analogy to think about when you think of these small nuclear reactors, think of them as a battery, okay? It's a battery that fits in the back of a truck, and it can go around, and you draw from it when you need it. But the battery lasts how long? It doesn't last a day, it doesn't last 2 days, it lasts 20 years, it lasts 15 years. It's compacted, you pick it up, you take it back, there's no on-site, you know, refueling or anything like that. It's a one-time core, it operates, and then you recycle it. So this is the vision that exists today. It's a very sensible vision. It can, again, it really lends itself to having a balanced portfolio along with renewables and other sources to bring down the carbon consumption.